Good evening, Potters. And welcome to our sixth all-class reunion. It's hard to believe these things began in 1987, and this is our sixth one. And we'd like to begin this one very appropriately with our East Liverpool High School alumni band doing a number under the direction of Lori Leneve Burse, 93, class of 93. And now I'd ask you all to please rise for the invocation by Reverend Ernest Peachy, class of 84, and remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance and the National Anthem by Janet Toot, class of 76. Please remove your hats.
Let us pray. O wise and eternal Father, we thank you today that you have blessed us to be able to come together from all around the country and all around the world to celebrate this alumni. We thank you for all these Potters that have come back home, and we come to celebrate. And we pray that this will be a wonderful, wonderful occasion for everybody. We pray for safe journeys even back home. We thank you, in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now here's the thing. I might or might not have talked too much this weekend. Those of you that know me will understand. We'll find out about 3/4 of the way through this national anthem. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. All the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets right there, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof to the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled
hear it again for Janet. I think that was outstanding. And now I'd like to introduce the president of the East Liverpool High School Alumni Association, Tom Snow, class of 66. Please sit down.
Thank you, Mike. I have to bring the mic down because he sticks it way up in the air. Good evening. It's been a great 4 days, hasn't it? By the way, that my job was to be responsible for the weather. So we had good weather and we had great crowds. You only had to be downtown last night around 11, 12 o'clock and you could really tell that. I want to start off by introducing you to our Board of Trustees. If you're here, would you please stand? Michael Parks, class of 68, is first VP. Deanna Shanifelt Clemens, class of 56, secretary. David Bickerton, class of 05. Brenda Shockey DeMasso, class of 77. Susan Cunningham Rossi, class of 81. Janet Toot, class of 76. Bonnie McNichol-Escola, class of 59. Cindy Hilliard, class of 74. Pamela Fluharty McDowell, class of 78. And Embry Wright, class of 84. Thank you for all your service that you give to this Alumni Association. Now I've got some good news and bad news. And that has to do with our financial picture. Our scholarship foundation is at $1.2 million. That's right, that's, you know, when we started out with zero and we're that far now. This year we gave $42,040 in scholarships to our high school seniors. Your Alumni Association needs your financial support. So please purchase a life membership if you have not already done so, or convince family members or friends to buy one. It's only $50 and it sure could help us. And if you're able, make a financial contribution to your Alumni Association from time to time. That could help us keep going. I want to give a big thank you to the reunion committee. Now, you've heard Mike Parks and Tom Snow, so as my daughter calls it, 2.0. Heidi Snow and Matt Parks, they did a tremendous job this week. Woo! We had five captains. If any of them are here, please stand. Now, these people have been working for almost 3 years to put this reunion on. You know, I had somebody email me and say, why don't you do this every year? And I said, well, we couldn't get anybody to do it if you had to do it every year. And there's 30 committees that put this on. 30 committee chairmen and many, many volunteers. So we want to thank all of them for all they did. Speaking of volunteers, it's volunteers that keep this organization working. I would like to name a few of them, but I know I'd miss a couple and then I'd be in big trouble. So I'm going to try to talk to each one of you personally at some point and tell you how much we appreciate what you've done. The thing that I want to let you know is that most of these volunteers are from the 50s. So I'm challenging the 60s and the 70s and even the 80s to come down and help. We've got a lot of projects that we do each year. Some of them take little effort, some of them take a lot. We could really use your help. I just thank each one of you for coming today. We're already looking at 22. What's that say? See you black and blue in 22. Back. That's what I thought I said. Back and blue. See you back in blue in 22. So thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you, Tom. A couple quick commercials. First of all, please patronize our vendors up here. They've paid to attend our event, and they have some wonderful food up here. So when we're finished here, if you're hungry, get a steak sandwich or a gyro or some French fries. Secondly, as I said before, this is our sixth all-class reunion. Something that a lot of people don't know is each time we do one of these things, it costs more than $50,000 to put one of these things on. The tents, the bands, the tables and chairs you're sitting in, the security, the fireworks, more than $50,000 each time we do one of these. That's the reason we ask you to register and pay $16 to register. We actually need more than 3,000 people to register each time we do one of these reunions, so it'll be break even. So, in case you didn't know that, being an ex-math teacher, I love numbers, so I always look at numbers. And as Tom said before, the Alumni Association founded the East Liverpool City Schools Education and Scholarship Fund back in 1987. And Frank Dawson was very instrumental in that, along with Delma Sanford and many others. And we've awarded scholarships to graduating seniors at East Liverpool High School each year for the last 29 years. And as Tom said, this year the total exceeded $42,000 that you have given to graduating seniors at our high school. I think you deserve a round of applause for that. And now we'd like to have a few more selections from our East Liverpool High School band under the direction of Lori Leneve Burse. Thank you.
Thank you. Tommy Kessel. He's still working, Tommy Kessel. All of them. Thank you.
Was that great or what? I could see Indiana Jones galloping across the prairie on that horse, and I said, how are they going to top that? And they just did that. You know, I feel kind of silly up here introducing our next presenter, kind of like nobody knows Frank. But I do have to tell one quick story. Some years ago, not 1987, it was 1992, he just clarified that for me. We were trying to think of something special to do for our reunion. So Frank dragged Tom and I to Princeton University, and we were there to watch, they don't call it a Potter Raid, but it's exactly like our Potter Raid, a parade that starts with the oldest class and turns itself inside out so everybody can see every unit. How many of you are in the Potter Raid today? I'm looking, I see 72, 60, I see classes all over the place. Is that a great parade or not? Well, you can thank Frank for that. I'd like to introduce, for some special remarks, Frank Dawson, class of 52, our founder and president emeritus.
You forgot to mention one special person went with us that day. Gretchen B.D. Dawson, my wife of 58 years. She's sitting right out here somewhere. So. And also, Jack Voder sponsored that trip, for which we'll be ever forever indebted, I think. So I'd like to recognize also two other ladies involved deeply in this organization and my life. One is our secretary, Deanna Plummins. She's sitting back here. And I took the key to the restroom. I hope you got it back. So, also, my right arm, my left hemisphere, my brain, Roberta Pennybaker. I see she's right out here. So, I just was in the office and in the hall here, and I looked at the picture of what we call the Tower Builders Hall of Fame. Some people on that wonderful, wonderful montage are gone. Some are living. I'm not going to embarrass them and have them stand, but the people that built this building, first of all, Herman Hoppel. Herman said today, he said this project was the greatest project of his life, and it was the greatest project of a lot of people's lives. Carl Buck, our past president, distinguished alum tonight, who did all the infrastructure way up on top there for the clock. Mark Hissen, who did all of the roof work and all of that beautiful woodwork inside. Dave Hoppel, who provided trucks and equipment, the time when we built the stadium over here in the apex of the triangle, and we knocked the street light off down here on Washington Street carrying bleachers from the county fairgrounds. Bob Smith, who did the lawn, remember the fire department, Ted Diddle, who's in a nursing home in Lisbon right now, Jim Pusateri, Mike Pusateri Jr., who did so much of the excavation, brought soil in from a lot somewhere out back of some cemetery that I don't think the lot owners know yet where it's under here somewhere. Tate Hilbert and his wife Beth, they come every reunion and remanufacture these doors, which Tate built the fan-like window above the doors, and they refinished them, and then the day after, Beth broke her wrist, so. We appreciate their efforts. We appreciate Don Ducky Rogers. Now, there's a guy with a real touch with a paintbrush. Unfortunately, he spilled a whole gallon right back here on the brickwork, but we had Chris Cowan repair it. Doug Sanford, who did the heating. Ralph McNichol, who's in the same facility as Ted Diddle. cut this grass faithfully. I know he said to his sister Bonnie, is the grass growing green? Well, I just, what other color would it grow? But I want to recognize, this is going to be a double recognition, Mike Tice. Mike was 9 years old when we started this project, and he's been helping us ever since. Does the stage for our annual pottery auction. Mike, we appreciate your efforts. We appreciate, and I see Rosie Makel sitting out here. She's the arm twister of East Liverpool. If she hasn't begged, borrowed, or stolen money from you, well, just hang on, she'll get you. Bonnie DeScola McNichol, faithfully. Bonnie and Mitzi Mercer and Marilyn Manley, I think, took residence here in this facility the last 2 or 3 weeks to get everything shaped up, and it just looks terrific. Those people are with us, and we appreciate so much all they've done. We have one other tower builder. When the idea of replacing the clock tower came to fruition at this location, the lot was owned by the Pottery Union, the Glass Molders and Potters Union. A very active member of the staff at the union, which at that time was located out across from Beaver Local High School, came to me and said, I think we can get ownership of this lot. The Pottery Union had planned to build a high rise for senior elderly potters. Their president was Jim Hatfield. The vice president was George Barbary. Many of you remember George. But the person that made this happen, this location happen, because the Kiwanis wanted to put it over here and somebody else over there, this was the place to put it because this is where it was originally located. We want to recognize this evening, she's going to retire as a member of the Board of Trustees, which she's been ever since the beginning, and acknowledge the indebtedness to her and her tremendous work ethic and what she's done for this organization. We're going to have you just stand, Martha. Martha Poland Bentz. Don't call me Frankie. Martha Tolan Bentz is hereby awarded the title of Trustee Emeritus for her long and tireless efforts by the East Liverpool High School Alumni Association, July 2nd, 2016. This plaque will be placed in the lobby as a tribute and an honor for what you've done. Thanks, Martha. The following individuals, and it's hard to believe these people are gone, have passed away. Roy B. Bud Watson, Tom Martin, spent every day from the time we broke ground in 1987 until we dedicated this building, doing heavy lifting, hard labor at this location. Geraldine Bulger Reed did all the displays inside the big cases. And by the way, the cases have been updated by Bonnie and Mitzi and Marilyn. Make sure you get a look at them before you go home tonight. They've done a terrific job. Mike Pusateri Sr., who was badly burned after dedicating so much time to this project. Andy Hester and Pat Hester. And I remember Andy Hester told all these young bricklayers that just got into the union, you come down if it's only for a day and lay some bricks on this facility and you'll remember it for a lifetime. And he was right. Gene Golden, our faithful secretary for many years, has passed away. Lucky Rice, who did all the tile work in the vestibule. Robert F. Beatty, who was our architect. Bob and Joanne Birch, who provided the carpet. Captain Video, Art Cloran, just passed away this year. and his sidekick, Ray Richards. If you haven't seen it, there's a terrific Ray Richards 1998 production on YouTube, on Facebook, that you'll be amazed the changes in this town from 98 to the day. Finally, we want to recognize a deceased member of that original crew. Kevin Sanford was our chairman, but our general contractor was Ronnie Tice. Ronnie, from day one, worked on this project as a general contractor, as a contributor of labor, intelligence, and every possible effort he could make to see this project completed. We mentioned his son, Mike, who was his sidekick from the first day. We want to recognize Ronnie, Mike, his wife, Crystal, Ronnie's widow, Shirley is over here, and his mother, member of class of 52, Jenny Tice. Would you please stand and be recognized? The Tice family, Ronnie Tice. This also will be, Ronnie's here. Jenny, where is Jenny? She won't, is she, oh, she is standing up. No, stand up. Okay. And Shirley is over somewhere. I saw her over in this area. Over, oh, there, and Shirley's over here. And this plaque, which will be displayed in the lobby, Ron Tice. 1953-2015, in memory of Ron Tice, class of 1972, general contractor for the clock tower. Thank you. I closed up at the Old Guard luncheon Wednesday, that seems like about a month ago, a little piece that I've used over the years. Blessed is the person who in this life can find a purpose to fill their day and a goal to fill their mind. Ah, the world is full of little people, contentious where they are. They don't know the joy that real success can bring. They don't have a will to go that far. And in this life, there is a need for some on this list to lead the rest, to rise above the average life, the giving of their very best. Ah, give me one who dares to try, when challenged by the task, to rise to heights we've never known. Or could this be too much to ask? This could be your year, a world to win, great purpose to achieve. If you'll accept the challenge Mike just gave us, the challenge that this organization gives us to help young people, and then in yourself believe. Ah, you'll make us proud. And at the close of every day, you'll look back on battles won, real glad, real pleased, real happy that you've come this way. I know from a very personal standpoint, I'm real pleased and proud of all we've accomplished as an organization. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sewers of Washington Street never back up into this tower basement. And may God hold you in the palm of his hands until we meet in 2022. Thank you.
You know, when Tom asked me to do this, I said, please tell me I don't have to follow Frank Dawson. He said, oh, no, no. And when I got here tonight, he said, you'll precede him and you'll follow him. So I just, thank you, Frank. You just heard about a whole bunch of distinguished alums, and you're going to hear about a few more
right now. We're going to present our Distinguished Alumni Awards. We'll begin with Carl Buck, the class of 56, presented by Charlie Lang.
Mike just stole my line. How do you be so fortunate as to follow Frank Dawson? What a wonderful and memorable way for Carl Buck to celebrate his 60th reunion with his fellow graduates of East Liverpool High School. Carl will have an opportunity here shortly to express his appreciation to all of you for this recognition. But I have a dilemma. My dilemma is that when I got the list of his accomplishments and what he's done in his community and in his church and in his business, it's as long as my arm. Now, I could stand here and recite that to you, but I'd rather not. What I really want to do is I'm going to try to help you get to know better or get to know the person, Carl Buck. Those of you from this area know it's no secret that we have had a loss in our population here. Well, Carl Buck, from the class of 56, and his wife, Jean, of 57 years, from the class of 58, have done their fair share to repopulate the area. They have four sons, one daughter, 10 grandchildren. I think they're all strung out in front of us on the front row here. And two great-grandchildren, and all of them live within about a 30-mile radius of East Liverpool. When discussing success, and when you're talking about Carl, you really have to be talking about success. The word mentor often comes into the discussion. Marvin Feldman, with a class of 62, and also a past recipient of the Hall of Fame, recently wrote a book in which he said he attributed a lot of his success in the insurance field to his mentors. So I asked Carl, I said, Carl, who have been your mentor or mentors? And Carl said it was my grandfather, Wiley Buck. His grandfather moved from Parkersburg, West Virginia, and established the Buck clan here in this East Liverpool area. Carl describes his grandfather as someone who could fix practically everything. He was a real Mr. Fix-It. Carl said that his grandpa Buck always seemed to have the right answer for any question, whatever it might be. But beyond that, his grandfather loved him, supported him, and taught him to always do his very best. I realized that Carl Buck was really describing somebody else that I knew when he told me this, and it was Carl Buck. And Carl Buck has grown to be somebody that his grandfather would be very proud of. Carl also can be called on to fix almost anything, from welding to upholstery, from refinishing furniture to antique cars. But he has shared his knowledge as a mentor and an educator with many others, particularly young people, and in his particular field of expertise, welding. On the job at the local 490 in Toronto, they established a trade school, and Carl, for 12 years, taught welding down there. He also, with the Jefferson County Technical School, taught, of course, welding. And then he joined the Columbiana County Joint Vocational School in Lisbon, and they established, what else, a welding program. It has been said that there is no higher calling than teaching young people. I would extend that. I would say that it is also particularly true when you're teaching young people to establish a career path for them, which will take them through the rest of their lives, and Carl's done that. I asked Carl what, in his opinion, was his most important leadership role through his 60 years. He first mentioned his 21 years as president of the Pipe Fitters Union, and then he corrected himself and he says, well, actually they're called the Boilermakers. And I thought, boy, now we're into something that I understand. A Boilermaker, you start with a shot glass and you have a mug of beer, right? Okay, well, in Carl's case, the shot glass is filled with energy and commitment to reach out to help others. The beer mug is filled with Carl's good old boy personality and his pleasure in making conversation with friends and strangers at every opportunity. But Carl went on to say that his leadership role that brought him the greatest satisfaction
was his 5 years as president of the East Liverpool High School Alumni Association. Carl served in that capacity until 2012, so the last reunion we had, all-class reunion, Carl was presiding over that. I'd like to tell you a bit about the Fish organization, but frankly, they have a big gong back there, and they're going to bring me down here in just a moment. But the Fish organization feeds hungry people here in this community, and we have no shortage of needy people that need that support. Carl is the coordinator, and his style of leadership is he does all the tasks, the big tasks and the little tasks, as well as leading. But under Carl's leadership, the recipients are all treated with respect and Christian love. There were things left out of the write-up, believe it or not, and one of them was the Community Builder Award, which was presented by the Masonic Lodge 315. Each year, this award is presented to an outstanding community leader who has made a major difference in our community. For the first time, they presented to one of their own because Carl had been very active as a Mason for 50 years. Just so you realize, he's kind of a diversified individual as well. He sings in the church choir. He sings in the community choir. He also has sung solos. He is also an actor on the Easter pageant on the Hill presented by the Trinity Church. I know that Carl feels quite honored with your recognition of him this evening, but I feel that I'm the one that really is being honored because Carl selected me to be his presenter. There is no one that works any harder, longer, or with more dedication than your friend and mine, Carl Buck.
I don't know about you, but that wore me out. Wow, he said things about me I didn't even know myself. But I'll accept it. Tell you what, thank you, Charlie, for the great welcome that you've brought with you tonight. I want to thank the Alumni Association for all their hard work, and I know it's hard work. So it's a yearly 365-day job. And I know what they go through. I'd like to also congratulate all the recipients. I'm in a great crowd, I think, don't you? I tell you what, 28 years ago, when this was a big pile of rubble, I thought, what are we building here? And I had a vision of what we were going to build, but I didn't think it would turn out like this. This is almost like something in Europe, that things that they do over there, things that they have done over there. But I didn't go to the meetings and I didn't go to the luncheons. I let them people sitting right here do all that. I got my hands dirty here, but I'll tell you what, they cleaned up real well. But I think this is one of the biggest highlights in East Liverpool today. And I'm glad I'm part of it. Charlie said I like to do things for other people. And I've always hated the word no. So a long time ago, I substituted three words for the word no. And when someone asked me if they could have a favor done by me for them, I'd either say yes, I'll try, or you want me to do what? 9 out of 10 times, it would work. And I am tickled to death that I could help. I think that the job that Heidi and Matt did for young people was tremendous. A lot of people had second thoughts about somebody that wasn't really at our age and whether they could handle it or not. But boy, they proved everybody wrong so far. So thank you very much. In my last newsletter, this was I don't know how many years ago, 2012, I think, something like that. I wrote on the back of one of the newsletters, and I was just trying to be funny, and my wife said, don't be funny tonight. She says, no jokes. Oh, brother, I'm almost like Frank, you know? He can't get away from him, but my wife said, no jokes. But anyhow, the last letter that I sent out, I put on the bottom of them, returned to the scene in 2016, but I never thought it would catch on. But evidently somebody picked up a little note on the bottom and run with it. And here we are, back at the scene in 2016. And I am thrilled to death. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Retired Major General Robert Marquette, class of 55, is unable to attend this evening due to family health concerns. He'll be represented by his high school friend, Jim Burson.
Good evening. Good to be back in the old hometown after 61 years ago I graduated here. It's actually good to be alive and be anywhere after all these years. We're here tonight to honor another 1955 graduate for his career, his hard work, and dedication to this country, especially during the Cold War with the Soviet Union. I'm referring to Bob Marquette, who became a two-star major general during more than 30 years in the U.S. Air Force. Bob and I had entered Ohio University after graduating high school here, and a year later, I left there and transferred to Youngstown University. They changed the name on the university up there since I went to Youngstown State University. And Bob stood up for me in 1957 when I married another 1955 graduate, Doris Hancock. Maybe some of you know her. Unfortunately, Doris passed away 6 years ago. During his long service career, Bob Marquette had commanded several air bases, and he flew 10 different kinds of airplanes, including the gigantic B-52, that big eight-engine bomber, and he also piloted the B-1 swept-wing bomber. He was awarded many honors, including two Distinguished Flying Cross medals. He served time in Washington, D.C., working at both the Pentagon and the White House in classified positions. In fact, when I interviewed him, he lives in Austin, Texas. When I interviewed him, I said to him, well, what kind of jobs did you have in Washington? And he said, well, Jim, I could tell you, but I'd have to kill you. And he had a lot of those classified jobs all during his career. I do know, though, that he was the director of emergency operations at the White House Military Office. While in the military, General Marquette also taught for a time at the nearby University of Pittsburgh. When I recently asked him for the best part of his career, what did he really enjoy, he said, I can't tell you how satisfying it is to work with the men and the women of the Air Force. They are the greatest group of people you can imagine. He says, I love to fly the planes, of course, but dealing with these people was the most enjoyable part of the job. And as far as excitement goes, General Marquette says, getting shot at while flying over Vietnam and Laos certainly did the trick. He was awarded one of the DFC's Distinguished Flying Crosses for commanding helicopters as they rescued two of the downed pilots near the infamous Ho Chi Minh Trail. At one point in his career, Bobby commanded three different air bases at the same time, two of them in California, where I live, and the third in Texas. He led other bases and air wings, including one which was part of SAC. And if you remember the Cold War, SAC was the Strategic Air Command during the Cold War with the Soviets. At that time, he flew those huge B-52s himself, loaded with nuclear bombs to counterattack if the Soviet Union had unleashed similar weapons on Washington and incapacitated the president and other leaders who could take over the government. Therefore, as a flying general, Bob had the authority to retaliate by issuing the orders himself and the secret codes to the missile silos, submarines, and other military units to launch their warheads toward the Soviets. And as he told me, thank God I never had to issue that order. General Marquette's favorite plane to fly was the B-1 Lancer. It's a swept-wing bomber capable of flying about 200 feet off the ground. They did that to avoid the enemy radar as it delivers its huge bomb load. The B-1 Lancer carried just as much and a slightly more bomb load than the big B-52 did. He told me it was an absolute thrill to pilot a B-1 at speeds in excess of 500 miles an hour while seeing the ground only 200 feet below. It would fly like this. If the hill was there, it jumped the hill, come back down, and flew at 200 feet at 500 miles an hour. But he said the B-1 handled just like a fighter jet. By the way, Bob was in charge of field development of that B-1 bomber. The general is a command pilot. He had more than 7,200 flying hours, including more than 700 in combat. He has a chest full of medals and ribbons, including the Bronze Star, the Legion of Merit, and Distinguished Service Medal. Now, Bob would have loved to have been here tonight. Wonderful guy, a teddy bear of a guy, and you will have enjoyed hearing him speak. But his wife, Shirley, is now recovering in Austin, Texas, at their home after suffering a stroke. He says his duty and his desire right now, of course, is to take care of her. But I'm very pleased tonight to say that General Marquette's sister, Mary Jo Rhodes, another East Liverpool graduate, I believe 1958, yes, 1958, is here tonight to accept her Big Brother's Award as distinguished alumni. Mary Jo.
Thank you, Jim. And thank you to the selection committee for bestowing this great honor on my brother. He has always been one of my heroes. He asked me to accept for him and sent me his sentiments that he wants me to relay to you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Wow, what an honor. I apologize to you for not being here in person to accept this distinguished award. However, circumstances in my personal life preclude me from traveling at this time. When I graduated in 1955, neither myself nor anyone who knew me would ever think me as distinguished, especially my teachers. So thank you very much. But among the hundreds, maybe thousands, who contributed to my life's achievements, I would first like to thank Jim Burson, a longtime friend who said he thought my career should be nominated for this honor. I told him it would be a fool's errand, but he ignored me and submitted my name anyway. Thank you. Next, I need to thank the selection committee for overlooking my numerous shortcomings in my past. To you, I am grateful. But I must give most of the credit to my good deeds that I have done in my lifetime to two families. First, the family that raised me. My father, mother, and sister Mary Jo taught me about the importance and value of honesty, integrity, the ethic of hard work, and love for one another. They gave me the foundation to go out and face the world, armed with the tools to survive in a very tough world. Along with them was a rather large, boisterous clan of grandparents, uncles, aunts, cousins, and they always kept me grounded. If ever I showed any evidence of a big head or inflated ego, my uncles, Jack Guerin or Herb Thompson, among others, would burst my bubble and bring me back to earth. But probably more important than anyone else was the support and forbearance of my immediate family, my wife Shirley and three wonderful children, who stayed with me through the numerous moves, change of location throughout the world, sometimes living in circumstances resembling slums. They never whimpered, well, maybe once in a while, but they hung in there. Their willingness to go with me, leaving friends and acquaintances, allowed me the freedom to pursue this Air Force career that I love so much. Their encouragement during the good times and bad gave me the confidence to accept risky career assignments. I have been blessed with people I love and who loved and supported me, helping me to develop into whomever I may be now. They all deserve the credit for whatever good I may have achieved. I am solely responsible for the screw-ups, and there have been monumental screw-ups. Lately, there are many people in the greater East Liverpool community, teachers, employers, and numerous friends who help mold this mass of human clay into something useful most of the time. East Liverpool was, and I still hope is a wonderful place to grow up and mature. Thank you all very much. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Our next recipient is Dr. Herschel Rubin, class of 33. How many of you saw him in the parade today, leading the parade? Dr. Rubin will be presented by his son, Leon Rubin.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. On behalf of my sister, Elsa Rubin Ephraim, and my wife, Susie, I'm really honored to present a man who, as it's a cliche to say, needs no introduction, but I think in this town, my father needs virtually no introduction. Just for fun, how many in the audience had glasses made by Dr. Herschel? I can't tell you how much fun it is to run into people anywhere and say, oh yes, your dad made my first pair of glasses. 6 years ago, when we were getting ready for the parade in which my father walked, we were talking about the fact that, well, you know, the next reunion is coming up, it'll be 6 more years, certainly hope you're going to be there. And my dad said, of course I'm going to be there, I may not walk in the parade, I might ride, but he said, I'll only be 100. And I'm happy to say that he achieved that goal, and as of the 4th, will be 100 and a half. Dr. Herschel Rubin has been a mainstay in this community for many, many years. He's served the community. He's certainly been a wonderful influence on us, his children, and on the other members of our family. And I think without any further ado, I would like to introduce my father, Dr. Herschel Rubin.
Coming through all right? Let me give you all a word of advice. If you're going to fall, don't fall on your head. I'm a little disappointed in the reunion this year. I wanted my class of 1933 to have its own individual reunion, but I couldn't find a phone booth. There has been a Rubin family in East Liverpool since the early 1900s. We always tried to, East Liverpool has been very good to the Rubin family, and we have always tried to give back to the community. So what I want to do is accept this award for my family and from all of my good friends, present and past, who have made me what I am today. Thank you.
You couldn't hear what he said. He said, "How'd I do? I stayed within the 3 minutes, didn't I?" Our next recipient is the late Joseph M. Wells, class of 06. That's 1906. And he will be presented by his grandson, Bob Kelly.
You're too tall, Mike. Thank you, Mike. And the committee, I'm honored and humbled to be here tonight to present, to be the presenter for Joseph Webb Wells as he's awarded the Distinguished Alumni Award. As Mike has said, he was my grandfather, and he was the epitome of the two words, honor and humility. He was a role model, if you will, and my cousins and I always talk about how we knew more about him, and he talked more about his accomplishments in life because he had many. He met a fine lady in Bethany College, and get ready for this. Her name was Fanny Fern Hanna. She became his wife. They had two wonderful children, my uncle, who was Joseph M. Wells Jr., and my mother, Virginia Rose Wells Kelly. There are five of us grandkids. My brother, obviously myself. Liz McIlvain is in the audience tonight. Jeannie Wicks is in the audience tonight. And the third of Joseph M. Wells' namesakes, Joseph M. Wells III. Some of him know him by Trey, some of him know him by Joe, but he was the third generation with that name. My grandfather pretty much had three passions in life beside his family. Number one was Homer Lachlan China. He also loved the community and he loved the game of golf. He was secretary and treasurer, general manager for 30 years in Homer Lachlan, following in his father's footsteps, who was W.E. Wells. W.E. Wells came from Steubenville, Ohio, was hired by the Homer Lachlan to run, be the accountant for Homer Lachlan China. One of the great things that my uncle had told me before he also has passed away, my grandfather loved Homer Lachlan, and he had a passion for negotiating for the United States Potters Association, which was a group of potteries that tried their darndest to get the federal government to listen to their problems about incoming goods coming into the country. And my grandfather and his father before him would go to Washington, D.C. on behalf of the United States Potters Association and try to get some tariffs, taxes, mainly leveled at that time, Japan, as they were sending in all kinds of things into the country, much cheaper. Of course, it still goes on today. Of course, the root of that evil right now is China, the country China. During his travels, my grandfather noticed some colored glazed dinnerware coming into the country. And he decided that maybe Homer Lachlan should try to make this as well. And of course, as you know what that came in today, is Fiesta dinnerware. Freddie Reed was the art director, and he designed actually the Fiesta shape and the colors, but my grandfather was really behind and pushed hard to get that done. And as obviously, it's been very popular and probably the most collectible dinnerware in the country, maybe in the world. He brought it back, it was discontinued, started in the 30s, discontinued in the 50s, brought back in the mid 80s. And of course, as I said, probably the most collectible dinnerware in the world today. My grandfather also loved his community. He was involved in so many things and so many different projects and clubs. And I'll just give you a brief example. The Chamber of Commerce, the Red Cross, Boy Scouts of America, the Salvation Army, the YMCA, served for many years on the East Liverpool City Hospital Board, and he was vice president of that organization for quite a few years. He also belonged to the West Virginia Chamber of Commerce, the West Virginia Manufacturers Association, was a member of the Masonic Lodge in Chester, and of course the Elks here in East Liverpool, of which his father was one of the original members. But his true passion in life probably was golf, and he was good at it. He started at the age of 15 in a little town of Newell, had a six-hole golf course called Kenilworth Country Club. That's where he learned the game from his father. And in 1914, 1916, and 1921, he was three times the runner-up in the West Virginia State Tournament. Then we turned to Ohio, and he had lots of success in Ohio. The first Ohio State amateur he ever played in, which is every amateur golfer in the state of Ohio, he won it. That was 1922. He lost in the semifinals at Inverness Country Club in Toledo in 23, but won again at Scioto Country Club in Columbus in 1924. He finished runner-up again at Portage Country Club in Akron, Ohio in 25. In 1926, he was runner-up again, losing in a 40-hole sudden death championship. My grandmother kept a scrapbook. In 1926, there was an article from the Akron Beacon Journal, and one of the sports writers had a caricature of my grandfather in there, and it said, if you want to contend in the Ohio Amateur Golf Championship, you got to go through Joe Wells from East Liverpool, Ohio, to do so. He reached the semis three more times during his career and had obviously an outstanding record. Then we turned to senior golf. In 1944, 45, 47, 48, 49, and 50, he won the Ohio Seniors Golf Tournament, held annually and still played today at various courses throughout Ohio. One of his proudest honors, and he never spoke of this, and I have to be perfectly honest with you, just recently, the rest of us found this out because I wasn't aware of this until we started doing a little research. In 1924, from the Chicago Tribune, the famous newspaper in Chicago, a gentleman, sports writer, kind of took it upon himself to be a little bit of an authority on amateur golfers in the country. He pulled a panel of golf writers all over the United States, and they came up with a list of the 16 best amateur golfers in the United States. Number one was a gentleman, and I don't know where he's from, Maxwell Martson. I have no idea where he was from, but my grandfather played him eventually in a couple matches and lost. The second person on this list, if you play golf, you'll know this name, Bobby Jones. He was number two on that list. And of course, he was the greatest decorated amateur golfer of all times here in the United States. Number 10 on the list, from East Liverpool, Ohio, Joe Wells. He was a 10th ranked amateur golfer in the United States. He then played a series of exhibitions with another golf pro who was fantastic at that time. His name was Walter Hagen. He traveled, the PGA Tour as we know it today didn't exist or was very, very weak. And so the pros would go around and play exhibitions. And my grandfather played several exhibitions with Walter Hagen right here in this area. They played at East Liverpool Country Club, they played at Portage Country Club, Steubenville Country Club, Brookside and Canton, and Youngstown Country Club. At Portage, there was four of them. Another gentleman that joined them a lot was a fellow by the name of Joe Kirkwood, who was the Australian Open champion. Then they switched partners a little bit, but when they went to Portage one time, and my grandfather lost the two-ball match, but he fired the course record at Portage Country Club at that time with a score of 67, which was fantastic. One little sidelight, I have to tell you the story. My cousins and I have talked about this. Walter Hagen stayed at my grandfather's house one time while they were doing this tour of exhibitions. And my Uncle Joe waited for 5 hours at the breakfast table, waiting for Walter Hagen to come down from upstairs so he could just talk to the man. He finally came down, and Walter Hagen had a various reputation for doing a little too much drinking and a little too much carousing. But my uncle waited him out. He finally came down and sat down, and my grandmother introduced my uncle to him, and Walter Hagen looked at my grandmother and said, Mrs. Wells, would you happen to have a real tall, cold glass of milk? Sure, she said, Walter, absolutely. And he said, oh, that'd be great. And could you put three fingers of brandy in that milk? This is about 9 o'clock in the morning, I guess. My grandfather went on to the Western, played a lot of golf in Western Pennsylvania. In the senior amateurs, he won that tournament in 47, 48, and 49, and 51. He turned to the U.S. senior golf tournament from amateurs from all over the country. In 1949, he finished second. He won in 1949 that tournament and finished second in 53 and 55. He played 10 years in senior international events in places such as England, Canada, France, and Denmark against the world's best amateurs. 5 times he was captain of that team. He was selected in 1996 to inducted into the Ohio Golf Hall of Fame, which is a tremendous honor. And again, if you know golf, there's people in that Ohio Golf Hall of Fame, people like Arnold Palmer and Jack Nicklaus. One of the best compliments I ever heard paid to my grandfather, though, had nothing to do with golf. He ran Homer Laughlin, like I said, for 30 years. And there were several people that came up to me in those 30 years, after those 30 years, and said, you know, I was with him, I worked for years in the office with him, or I saw him go through the plan or whatever. And the same compliment was always paid to him. They said never once did he ever raise his voice to anybody. I thought he didn't have to. That's the way my grandfather was. He had this aura about him. And when he came to the room, you knew he was there. He was truly a humble person, never bragged about himself, never told any of us really about his great accomplishments in golf. That was his style. My cousins and I would often wish we had spoken more to him about this. But again, he would never brag. He was a truly humble man, and he had to be proud of all he did achieve during his time here on earth, but you would never know it. On behalf of my family, I would like to say thank you for this honor, and if he was here today, he would be very, very proud.
Our next recipient is Jane Snow, the class of 1967, and she'll be presented by her brother, Tom Snow.
This evening, I am very proud and honored to present my sister, Jane Snow. Jane graduated from E.L.H.S. in 1967. And cum laude from Kent State University with a Bachelor's of Arts degree in English. She also studied journalism in the Master's degree program at Kent. She is the former food editor and restaurant critic for the Akron Beacon Journal, where she worked for more than 28 years. Her work appeared in more than 250 newspapers in the United States, Canada, in Australia. When Jane was nominated for her first of 2 James Beard Awards, the ceremony, which was held at the Waldorf Astoria in New York, she took my mother as a guest. She told her mom that she did not expect to win because she was up against so many major newspapers. That just being nominated was enough. When they called her name, she could hardly stand up. She was also nominated a second time for another article. At one time, she was the president of the Association of Food Journalists, an organization of magazine and food writers from across North America. She was also the regional vice president and a member of the executive board of the Newspapers Guild, a union of more than 30,000 members. You know, I thought I would tell her that I knew a little bit about food, and so I read an article in the newspaper once about tainted strawberries coming in from Mexico. So I called her up and I said, Jane, did you hear about this? And she said, who do you think broke that story? I think that was the last time I called her about any article I had read. But she was nominated for a Pulitzer on that article. She also was nominated another time for a Pulitzer on a different article. Since leaving the newspaper, she writes for magazines and web articles. She has a cookbook called Jane Snow Cooks. It was published by the Akron University Press. And it's not your typical cookbook. There's a story about each recipe in there, maybe where she found it or who gave it to her. So I'm very proud to introduce my sister, Jane Snow.
Wow, thank you. Thank you, brother, for those wonderful remarks. It almost makes me forgive you for what you said to my future husband when I introduced you to him. He looked Tony in the eye and said, run. Yeah. But really, I am honored and thrilled for this recognition in my hometown, and as for something that I really love doing. And to be in the company of such accomplished fellow honorees. I was lucky enough to write for a newspaper, to be a reporter in the heyday of newspapers, before they started, you know, cutting their coverage and essentially committing suicide. My newspaper sent me all over North America, from Vancouver, Canada, to New Orleans, to essentially eat. I got to interview and dine with people like Martha Stewart and Julia Child and Emeril Lagasse. Of course, it wasn't all fun and games. I remember I once had to taste almost 100 fruitcakes for a story. And on one horrifying night in a fancy restaurant, my appetizer, which was a frozen sea urchin, gradually started to thaw and walk across my plate. But still, it was a wonderful career. And East Liverpool is where all my adventures began. And it was a wonderful place to grow up. And what wonderful people I met here. I am grateful to everyone who encouraged me, especially my family. My mother Jean, who was my traveling companion and best friend, was my staunchest supporter, and my brother Tom and my sister Dee were and are shining examples of everything that I admire: intelligence, kindness, high principles, and generosity. I thank them, and I thank the Alumni Association for this honor.
Getting paid to eat. It doesn't get much better than that. And speaking of eating, our next recipient I naturally think of Klondike bars. I don't know why. Our next inductee is the late Harold Bricker, class of 48, and he'll be presented by his grandson, Greg Stansberry.
Well, first, thank you for honoring my grandfather with this award. You know, my grandfather was certainly a humble man, and whose life was built on faith. It's probably been 4 years ago now he was accepting another award for his work in the community. And, you know, he's very straight to the point person. He's simply said thank you and quoted his favorite passage from the Bible. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. To me, this pretty much summed up my not only my grandfather, but my grandmother as well. They have done a lot in and for this community, but we would never know. During his funeral, a local representative from a nonprofit came and told a story about my grandfather giving a donation, and said when he gave the donation, you know, if anyone ever found out, it won't happen again, basically. So you certainly won't see any buildings named after him. It's obvious that my grandparents have played a large role in my life, and certainly the cornerstone of my family. It's been a year since my grandfather has passed, but his legacy still lives on. I just got roasted as outgoing president for a trait that was passed down to me of being cheap, but I don't find it as being cheap. It's just he taught me when you work hard for a dollar, that dollar's hard to give up. So you're certainly a leader, leading by action and not words. He taught me to put others before myself, and he was a prime example of, you know, with hard work you will be successful in all that you do, and he would certainly not hesitate to help someone in need. So again, thank you for honoring my grandfather with this award.
Our final recipient is Clark Wilson from the class of 1975, and he will be presented by Jason Croxall.
This is an amazing event, being able to stand here before you, and I get to introduce someone to you, because not many of you might not know Clark. You might not understand exactly what Clark has done. So I asked a few people around, and they said, do what Frank does. You know, take a few notes, list their accomplishments, and kind of let them tell it. So I asked Clark, what did he do? Well, after 15 minutes of talking, I almost ran out of paper. So I wanted to list a few things about Clark, and I wanted to also say that how nervous I am. So I want you to excuse me, because not only am I standing here talking as an alumni member, but my first grade teacher is in the audience as well. So Mrs. White, I hope I get this right. We talked, and Frank introduced us, and he spoke to us about a gift and about being able to meet a challenge and about, oh, that person that will try, and about being able to believe in what we wanted. I want to talk to you tonight about someone who did believe and about someone who was given the gift of being able to believe in what they wanted to do. It's said that if you do what you love, you'll never work a single day in your life. And I don't know one day that Clark has had to go to work. You see, have you ever heard Clark? I don't mean heard of Clark, but have you heard Clark? Clark is a little, not exactly, he and I both are a little bit vertically challenged, but the man is one of the most silent giants that I know. He's humble, and he'll never speak about his accomplishments to you to brag or to build himself up. But if you ask him to show you what you need to know and about what he does, he'll do it. So what brings Clark here today for us as being a distinguished alumni? What brings us here is a belief that Clark could do things, and that began with Helen Richards, his grandmother, with piano lessons. And that followed four more with some organ lessons and playing. And see, what Clark can do in that small stature is at his fingertips, he commands the largest instrument in the world, that of the pipe organ. It can be as silent as a whisper that can tickle the tiniest part of your heart, and it can be so loud that it could rumble you seriously and virtually out of your seat. That's the instrument that Clark became a master of in his years of training. And that training began all because he went to all of these piano lessons, and at age of 11, his parents, who were both teachers inside of the East Liverpool City School District, John and Donna, they were able to instill with him that ability to believe and to keep going forward. And at age 11, he traveled to go see a gentleman play. His name was John Murray. And when he watched a silent film, which was a Spanky, an Argang film, played and accompanied by a pipe organ, a theatrical organ, Clark fell in love. It was at that point in time that he wanted to learn this instrument. He wanted to play this instrument. And he thought, if he can do this, I really want to do it. And so he tried, and he believed in what he did. And it took some time. But his travels took him to all sorts of different places. You see, Clark in East Liverpool might not bring up a lot of memories. It might automatically be one of those names that sparks something, but he has influenced thousands of our graduates' lives. Clark began working immediately after high school, and he started working at the Shantz Organ Company. In working with the Shantz Organ Company, he learned how to build the pipe organs, he learned the intricate insides of the pipes, he learned how to voice pipes, he learned how to do the wiring inside of these pipe organs that were originally built in the early 1900s to the 1920s with intricate miles and miles of wiring, and he also learned how to play it, and how to play it like no one else could play it. This traveled him throughout the United States, playing at different areas that had these pipe organs. And in 1978, to graduating in 75, Clark found himself in Mesa, Arizona, at Pipe Stop Pizza Parlor. He learned how to be a voicing and a constructionist. He traveled throughout North America, throughout England, in Wales, in central London, and also Australia, where he has done the work on these pipe organs that are throughout the entire world. He's been a consultant in over 200 major jobs with those. His concert tours and playing has taken him throughout the world as well. Clark is one of the only, one of six people that are known as a living link to people who knew those who scored the silent film industry and plays the pipe organ for that, and has been taught directly with them. Clark has been the resident organist at the Capitol Theater in Columbus, Ohio for 25 years and directs the film festival there every summer for 3 months. He has scored over 65 silent films on his own. He is able to be a part of the Los Angeles Conservatory, where they watch over how pipe organs are restored and what the movement will be to be able to keep them alive with inside of the world as living history. He has performed at the Disney Concert Hall in Los Angeles. And Clark was also asked by the Academy of the Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences to perform at the 100th anniversary of Paramount Studios. Clark was asked to play the original scoring of Wings. And he played that to the who's who of all of Hollywood. And in that met A.C. Lyles, one of the producers who worked throughout the silent film industry and produced films into his 90s, and spoke with him there. He has been broadcast by National Public Radio multiple times. He has performed live performances with Michael Feinstein, Mickey Rooney, and Ann Miller. especially with the tour of Sugar Babies, where, as Clark explained to me, he got to see Ann Miller and her dance moves and share the organ bench with Mickey Rooney. He's published journals inside of the American Guild of Organists and the American Theater Organ Society. He has taught classes at Indiana University Bloomington. He's designed the theater organ history and silent film scoring. He's designed that curriculum for the University of Oklahoma, where this spring he will be an adjunct professor performing those classes for them. But of course, his pinnacle of performances happened just this summer in East Liverpool, Ohio, at the First Free Methodist Church right around the corner, playing a great Buster Keaton film, Seven Chances. But I will say this, Clark, these are a list of the things that he did. It all started with a belief that he could do it. His parents let him use his basement as their theater and where they were able to perform. So his friends would put on these shows, and it let Clark grow with this idea that he could do, and he did. And what I want to bring to light is how Clark has been able to instill that idea of belief that you can be something more than what someone else might tell you. You see, Clark secretly brought himself back to East Liverpool, even against his mother's wishes, to play and accompany all of the high school musicals. His first major performance before all of these worldwide performances happened at East Liverpool High School for My Fair Lady. And he returned to East Liverpool High School from 1976 to 1988 and accompanied each and every one of those musicals, working with the cast members, working with folks that couldn't sing, and I was definitely one of those. And Clark asked me, "Can you play an instrument?" Ladies and gentlemen, it is an absolute pleasure to be able to introduce you and to put out all of those wonderful accomplishments, but to also tell you that this is a man that you would never hear any of these accomplishments ever from him. So I wanted to list them before you and tell you he is one of the most humble and yet one of the greatest players that I've ever heard and one of the greatest friends I've ever had. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Clark Wilson.
Thank you so much, Jason. Well, I feel like we're somewhat set up for a good old debate session now, where Jason has had 5 minutes to set me up, and now I have 3 minutes to talk my way out of it. Well, it seems to me that you're not usually, and very often, recognized in your own backyard. And I do most sincerely appreciate the honor that all of the members and the administrators of the Alumni Association that they have bestowed on me. And it is a treat beyond description to be on the stage with the people that you see in front of you, people who have built our community, done so much for East Liverpool, people who have been here for 100 years. It's an incredible bunch to be here, and thank you so much for the award. My grandmother, as Jason said, was Helen Richards. She played at the First United Methodist Church down the street for 43 years. And she said to me once upon a time, "You know, dear, there's no sweeter, greater, or better success than living your life in your own way." And I have been able to do that. Again, as Jason said, it feels like I've not worked a day in my life. What a treat that is. So I blame all that I do on her and her inspiration, which goes on to this very day. All of us sitting here this evening are from a small town. And in my travels around America, whether it's Toronto, Atlanta, Chicago, Los Angeles, New York, dozens of places in between, I'm always amazed how many people know of East Liverpool. How many have heard of it? How many have been here? How many have passed through? It's a lot of fun to think that we're out there everywhere in America. I drove by the old McKinley school building today. Built 1906, 110 years old, one of the few of our old education system that still stands. It brought back many memories of my childhood, of my good friends, of neighbors, of grand old people in this town that ran businesses that haven't been here for many, many years. But more than anything else, it made me think of our education system here in East Liverpool. And that education system is really why we're all here now, and why this Alumni Association exists, because of the education that we got here. In my sphere of operation, and I know everybody will have their own list of favorites, there were teachers that came to mind, people that had tremendous influence on our young lives and certainly built their profession into something more than just a profession. Hazel Neisser, Jean Conrad, Nancy Wetzel, Jane Carey, H.K. Langdon, who could ever forget him, Jean Felice, Jim Martin, who recently left us. All grand people. And if I can take a personal moment, I'd like to add my own mother to that list, Donna Richards Wilson, who was hired by the Board of Education in 1968 to introduce sex education into the curriculum. Well, she was picketed and everything else that you could do at the time when SEX was whispered along with toilet paper and ads on TV and things like that. Well, anyway, these people were wonderful people, and the list goes on and on. There are so many more. Around the country, many of my colleagues in the art world have come from fancier schools than we, that had greater facilities, maybe greater advantages, certainly more money. But none of them came out with more integrity or higher ideals than what our hometown standards and spirit have given us. It's truly us and our extended alumni family here and around America who keep that spirit burning, fired by this Alumni Association. I'm so very proud of all of us and where we are at this moment in time, and I'll carry this living honor and trust of East Liverpool with me for the rest of my life. Thank you so much again.
Let's give our distinguished alums another round of applause. I'd also like to ask anyone in the audience or on the stage or within my voice that can hear me, if you've been a previous distinguished alum, if you could please just stand and be recognized. Great people. And now you're in for another real treat. Some choral selections by the East Liverpool High School Alumni Choir, directed by Lisa Ensinger, class of 86. I saw this whole front row down here tapping their feet. Thank you very much. That was outstanding. Thank you. Carl said that's his whole family in the front row. Well, the good news is we're ahead of schedule. We weren't supposed to end until 9:30. The bad news is the fireworks don't begin until 10. So when we conclude here, the fireworks will be on the parking lot behind the AAA, across the street from what used to be Mike Turk Chevrolet or Buckman Chevrolet. It'll be in that parking lot. You should be able to see them from anywhere behind the library. Before we end, I would just like to give a personal thank you, a personal note of commendation to the class of 2016 and the courage they exhibited at their graduation ceremony by reciting the Lord's Prayer. Thank you once again to the committee. I don't think we can thank them enough. They have done another phenomenal job with this reunion. Thank you to all of you for coming from all over the United States. And I see a classmate back there who told me last night he came all the way from France for this reunion. And Frank said we have someone from Japan here, so that's wonderful. We know where she is. We're going to close with the singing of the Alma Mater, a solo by Matthew Ball, class of 1997. I've already informed him that probably some of us will be joining in, so it may not be a solo. We do ask you to stand for the singing of the Alma Mater, followed by the 1812 Overture. Thank you all for coming. See you back in the blue in 2022.
If I could please just take one moment and dedicate this to my father, John Ball. He has served this community for a number of years before moving, and he loves this town, and he taught me to be proud of it. And also to my three-year-old son. No matter where we go, I always want him to know that there are amazing things that come from small towns. Yeah. So if you would, please join me. East Liverpool, the school which now we honor, we sing our song to devotion to you both now and in coming days. East Liverpool, we pledge our deep devotion.
Thank you.